Kyle Henderson of Bama football on YouTube joins us at Bama YouTube on Twitter. If you want to give him a follow, how are you, sir?
What's up, fellas? How you doing? Long time no talk. Happy to be back.
Man, we're glad to have you, and you're one of our favorites. We want to get some of your thoughts around the SEC, but yeah. Let's go ahead and start with Bama.
Hold on, Chad. I wanted to thank Kyle because after I asked him if he could hop on for like 15, 20 minutes, I noticed that his sister is visiting him this weekend.
Yes.
So he's doing this. He has company. And so I just wanted to know, like, how long has it been since you've seen your sister? And, like, how much credit do we need to give you for giving us some time when you could be giving it with family?
So, obviously, I'm not from Tuscaloosa. I'm from New Mexico. And anytime I have an opportunity to get family out here, it's great. You know, the kids love to see family. My sister, we're really close. She used to live in Dallas. She just moved back to New Mexico. So she's out here for a week. Took it a Waysider. So over here in Tuscaloosa, grits are really a thing. And so we went for like an original breakfast to where Bear Bryant used to eat at. And it's like the skillet hasn't been cleaned since like he coached here. So we went there. We're having a good time. And my kids get back at 3:30. So I have some time. So I'd love to talk some college football. And, you know, happy to have family here for sure.
How old is your sister in that picture?
My sister will be 30 and I will be 40 this year.
Yeah. She looks good for 30. Yo,
good. The jeans are good, man. Look, the jeans are good.
I was gonna say that picture. I don't think they do selfies like and put them in a store like when we're old enough where they used to. You go by frames, yeah. And they just put pretty people in the frames to let you know. Y'all were about as pretty a picture as I've seen in a while, dude. I'm telling you,
Chad. That's a good way of putting it.
I saw the same picture Ketch saw, and I went, "Damn, they look good." I want to go to that restaurant just because y'all look so good at the table.
But my concern was that I was going to give him a compliment, and she'd be just like 2 years in the college or something.
Right.
No. She is single. So, and she's a speech pathologist. She's great. She's fun. She's coming with it and, you know, happy to have her out. So.
Okay. Very cool. All right.
Orange
so
bloods, do your thing. There it is.
All right, Kyle. So tell us what you've seen out of Bama since have we talked to you right after the Texas game and kind of what all that was.
Yeah.
Give us how you're processing what you've seen with the South Florida game and now getting, obviously, winning that game, but it was certainly strange in ways, and then you get to the Mississippi win.
Yeah, I think when you look back to this first part of the season, it wasn't complete for Alabama, and I think that Texas game, it really affected them in terms of waking that team up, and it didn't transpire that well to the next game, which went over in South Florida. And I don't think you can't criticize Coach Saban a lot on the things that he did or in the past, but I think the way that he handled that quarterback situation in the fall camp going into this season was just not good for the team. I think the team needed to know who the quarterback was going to be, and I think even in that game against Texas, Jalen Milroe was kind of looking behind his shoulder, like scared to make plays or scared to throw interceptions or whatever, because going into that entire season, you know, we're thinking like who is going to be the quarterback, and if he throws the interception, is it going to be pulled out? He didn't even start against South Florida, and it's interesting, and I tweeted this out and I think you retweeted me, Ketch. Alabama hasn't led since the first game of the season at halftime. They were down to Texas 13-6 against South Florida. It was 3-3. And then last week against Ole Miss, it was 7-6. So Alabama did put together two quarters of very impressive play against Lane Kiffin just this last week. So I'm curious to see if they can carry that momentum in to Mississippi State, where they're playing on the road on Saturday at 8 p.m. on ESPN. They're an 11-point favorite. Jalen Milroe has a lot of confidence. He was 17-21. Against Ole Miss, he did, that was the best football that he's played thus far, but the defense really played well. And besides those three touchdowns that they allowed to Texas in the fourth quarter, the defense has been really good. So curious to see if Alabama can build on that momentum going into this weekend.
Kyle, it's kind of strange to look at the national passing efficiency numbers and see Milroe ranked in the top 20. Because there's a part of me that's like, okay, now we've got four or five games, I guess one less because he didn't play in the one game, but it feels like we've got a little bit of a sample size.
No.
He's pretty good. And do we look back on what happened as a panic? Look, you can tell us, I swear, Chad and I won't tell anybody if this happened. Was he suspended? We won't tell anybody. We won't say.
No, like, there was I was told that he was not suspended. I think Saban said that he was going to play two other quarterbacks to give those guys an opportunity. And I think the way that he looked at it was they were going to beat South Florida no matter what. And I always keep telling people during the fall camp, Saban said this: I don't care about stats. I care about winning the game. So he didn't care if they were going to have to beat South Florida by whatever. Like, he just wanted to have those guys get an opportunity. Look, Ty Simpson looked okay, but he's not capable to win street fights. Jalen Milroe can win street fights. I think a lot of people forget that Alabama was beating Texas. There's no moral victories. Texas would have beat Alabama, I think, probably 7 out of 10 times this season at that point of the season. That they were a better team. They're a better team right now. But Alabama is trending upwards, and it's up to them to get back and, you know, be able to beat Mississippi State. It's no longer like we're in the SEC West Championship. It's got to beat Mississippi State. Then we got to beat Texas A&M. They're about to go on a gauntlet of their schedule. Like most teams are, I was looking at the top 10 right now. Nobody's really has a marquee win in, you know, besides Texas and I think Ohio State, right? Everybody else has kind of played powder puffs and the season's about to start. But Texas has a quality win over Alabama, and then Ohio State beating Notre Dame, I think, is an impressive win as well.
Now, Kyle, the interesting thing about all of this is that if Nick Saban, I think, looked stressed and we were getting kind of the angry Nick Saban that we've seen at times in his career, that maybe it would feel like the team or the program is feeling stressed. But it feels, interestingly enough, like one of the reasons why they've gotten through this stretch and maybe now are coming out of it on the other side potentially really well is that he's been real loosey-goosey this year. I mean, even this week I saw a piece of media, it might even have been you, retweeting a clip that you had where it was like, I talked to two or three sports psychiatrists, psychologists, and we talk about ways that I'm going to talk to the team that week. And it's like, wow, you know, like there's, it just, it doesn't feel like there's any crisis going on, despite the fact that every time Alabama loses a game, I think there's inherent urge from everybody around the program to invent a crisis. He's been really captain cool so far this year.
Yeah, and I think, Colby, you're right. That Florida State win at the time over LSU, I would say that is a good win. But despite that, Florida State, I don't think over the last 2 weeks, I mean, they could have very well lost to Boston College. They should have lost to Boston College, and they should have lost to Clemson. Clemson missed a field goal, and they should have beat them 100%. So, but you're right. At that point, I would label that a good one as well. I think Coach Saban and I did retweet that. He meets with Pat McAfee every Thursday right here on YouTube, and he meets with the sports psychiatrist to kind of build out the message for the team. And one of the things that's been interesting about this particular team is this team isn't complete by any means. The past couple of teams, they've come into the season such a juggernaut that he's had to kind of send messages through the media to kind of get them fired up. This year, he's been much more lax because I don't think the team really has an identity. And I think if he was to really go, you know, get like mad at the team or do one of his things, it might, you know, go against their psychological disposition in a negative way. So I think he's doing a great job coaching these bunch up and continuing to mentor these guys. I think if this team is ever to be completed, then he will get to that point again. But I think he's playing some chess out there, and I think he's doing it from kind of a mentorship kind of coaching standpoint. Saban does a lot of things from like the psychology realm, and this is could be one of those things that he's doing to where he's still coaching the team in a specific way. I don't think he's gone soft by any means, you know, where he's kind of more chill. I think he's just coaching a different way because this is a completely different team than we're used to the last three or four teams. But the way that the defense played was inspiring, honestly, and I think someone in the comment box just said that Alabama is probably a better team than LSU right now. We'll find out in a couple weeks when those two teams play, but I would probably say, yeah, in the way that the defense is playing and if the offense finds itself, Alabama is going to be right there in the thick of things with the SEC West 100%.
Kyle, it kind of leads me to my next question, and it was kind of an around the SEC type of thing. Obviously, you focus in on Bama and where they are and keeping track of that. If somebody walks up to you right now and says, hey, outside of Bama, what's going on in the SEC? Where does your brain go first? Is there a team that immediately starts blinking at you? Is it a game that's coming up? Like what about the rest of the SEC has your eye right now?
I think the fact that Georgia necessarily hasn't played anybody just yet, but they are 4-0 on the season. They're about to play Auburn. Carson Beck, he has 1,100 yards on the season. I want to continue to see how this Georgia team is. And I think one of the things that it is promising about Georgia's program is the way that they are able to switch their offense within the last couple of seasons, right? They used to be a kind of a 3 yards in a cloud of dust, but ever since they went to a more balanced attack and were able to get some wide receivers that can stretch the field, they've been elite. They've been able to win, you know, national championships, kind of like how Alabama was able to change their offense. So I look to Georgia as still kind of that team that everybody has their eyes on. When I look to other teams in the SEC, I want to see how good is that LSU team, especially when they come to Bama. I want to see how Tennessee plays Alabama as well. And I look to teams that are about to join the SEC, to be honest. I mean, Texas. I look to Oklahoma. I don't think a lot of people are talking about Oklahoma right now or USC. And those two teams could be very dangerous. And I know every single year they're like, this is the year for USC, or this is the year for Oklahoma. I know I've said the same thing, but those two teams are pretty capable. And the reason is their quarterback play. Dylan Gabriel is a fine quarterback, 1,200 yards with 12 touchdowns right now. And then you have the returning Heisman winner and Caleb Williams. Have you guys seen, what is his name? Zachariah Branch, the freshman for USC? He might be one of the most exciting players in college football since Reggie Bush. Ironically, the same school at USC, right? But that guy is a blazer. So, and it seems like it's funny because this is like the Pac-12 is about to crumble, but this is like their Alamo year. Like all those teams are ranked, right? We're all like focusing on the Pac-12. Washington's ranked, Oregon's ranked, and Dan Lanning's mad, and he's playing for wins, not clicks. And, you know, Coach Prime has shifted the entire atmosphere to Boulder, but this is their kind of last hurrah. So I'm looking at teams to join the SEC. Texas right up there, you know, 4-0, taking on another 4-0 Kansas team. And then after that, you guys have Oklahoma after Texas?
Next Saturday.
Yeah, those are some great games that are lined up and should be very entertaining. So Dylan Gabriel's a fine quarterback for sure.
Now, Kyle, I hate to ask this question to you. By the way, I think you're right. The fact that two Big 12 guys and you're like a hybrid, Chad. So you're like 1.5 SEC guys and half of a Big 12 guy, or however that works. I don't know. Don't ask me to count to three. But regardless, we are talking about Pac-12 football a little bit with actual respect. Like, who knew that could happen? But I hate to ask you this question. Because if anybody has done the playoff and understands that October teams or September teams don't automatically end up being November and December teams, it would be an Alabama reporter who's kind of seen it all at this point. I mean, is it in your first rodeo? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask you for, as of today, the four teams that you think are playoff teams with the caveat of it could change in 5 minutes.
I would say Georgia, Texas, either Ohio State or Michigan, or both of those teams. I don't think Florida State is a playoff team. I don't think Penn State is a playoff team. I don't think Washington is a playoff team. Possibly USC, depending on how things run with, you know, the rest of the Pac-12. So those would kind of be my five teams. USC, the bubble team, kind of being subbed in if Michigan and Ohio State were to lose two particular games. So Georgia versus USC, and maybe a Texas versus a Michigan or something like that. I think those are the teams. And then after that, I'd probably be an Alabama at that sixth spot underneath USC.
Yeah, kind of crazy. Top 10 right now, one SEC team, four Pac-12 teams in the top 10.
That's what I'm saying. Like even Utah. Crazy. I mean, Utah is number 10. They're about to play Oregon State. And ironically, I think they're a 3.5-point underdog against Oregon State. So the Pac-12 is about to find itself pretty soon. Oregon's about to play USC. And I think if USC is able to run the tables, then they're probably right there. And I think people want them in because, you know, the head coach, the name, the Heisman Trophy. Plus, they're a pretty good football team, to be honest.
Kyle, I wanted to get your thoughts on the two teams I watched play last week. Being an Aggie, I'm watching A&M play Auburn. They look impressive, and the other half of the Iron Bowl looks bizarre right now. Auburn was just stumbling all over itself. I can't imagine a Bama fan's very scared about that trip to Auburn. Talk to me about the Tigers, but then also, do you think there's reason for optimism among Aggie fans, especially considering the quarterback injury?
Yeah, I mean, that was gigantic news. You know, some of the biggest news in college football was, the quarterback being out the season. The ironic thing when talking about Texas A&M is Max Johnson will step in, 6'6", 220 pounds, and he transferred from LSU, where he did play against Alabama back in 2021, throwing for like 225 yards. Alabama was able to win that game 20-14, but I was reading the message boards, and people were like, actually, I'd prefer to go against the other quarterback than Max Johnson. So they have athletes. The last time that Alabama made a trip to College Station, Jimbo Fisher was able to be the first former assistant to beat Nick Saban head-to-head. I think Kirby might have done it before. Either way, it was like one of the first two. So Texas A&M playing in that environment, I think, will be challenging for Alabama. With that said, ironically, again, Jalen Milroe was able to beat Jimbo Fisher last year, and that was the only game he started last year because Bryce Young went out against Arkansas, then steps in, and then he beat Jimbo. I asked Jimbo Fisher at SEC Media Day, as I was like, what was it like preparing for Jalen Milroe? He was like, it was terrible. I mean, you don't know what the guy is capable of. And kind of getting back to you, Ketch, one of the numbers that I wanted to point out with on Pro Football Focus, Jalen Milroe's deep ball grade is 98.1 or something crazy like that. But his intermediate passing grade is 28.6.
Oh.
So it's like he was some of the, like the you know, as some of the highest graded quarterback, if not the highest graded quarterback in college football with the deep ball. But that intermediate is where he's thrown three interceptions. Think we just lost Catch. Hey, welcome to House Divided. I'm the new host, Kyle Henderson, along with Chad Hastings. Like and subscribe. We've kicked Catch off, and we're flying the ship now.
Well, see, and here's this is be good for the people because they've been freaked out about Catch's shirt the last few weeks. Folks, you see that color in the background? With Kyle, that's crimson.
Yes.
That's crimson. I'm wearing maroon. Ketch's shirt is neither of those two things.
Yeah.
Neither.
Yeah. Ketch is gone. Kicked him out. Like and subscribe if you want me and Chad to fly the ship for the rest of the day.
That's it. Dude, I don't think, you know what? We could probably do a whole lot worse than letting you take over a little bit since you got a lot going on YouTube right now. Hey, where is the Bama fan right now? Those people that are hardcores and they're following you and they want to know what's going on. Did the Ole Miss game, do you think, did it bring them back up to a certain level where they kind of shook it off and now they're ready to roll?
Yeah, so I can see the analytics on my YouTube channel just like you guys can. And the analytics before, welcome back, Jeff Ketchum. Thanks for joining us. So like and subscribe, Ketch is back. So I could see the analytics and before the game against Ole Miss on Friday on Thursday and Friday, I was like, oh shit, like I might have to start looking for other ways to start generate some income, because you could see it completely dipping because fans, what was happening was fans thought that Ole Miss was going to beat Alabama. Like 50% thought that Lane Kiffin, they were buying the trolls coming in, that they were going to lose. I promise you. So that's what happened in that second half. In the beginning of the game, it was hot. People were just, it was muggy. Ole Miss, it looked like that first drive, they were going to score however many points they wanted to. But then the second half, fans started to rise up, and a quarterback sack made a fan cheer, and another fan cheered, and then everyone was cheering. And so, and then the offense threw a long pass, and the people were like, roll, Tide, roll. So the offense started getting going, and then Alabama was able to really start to be the Alabama team that we thought they were. And we're like, wait, is this the team that was losing 7-6? Jalen Milroe comes out, and he has this incredible post-game press conference. Honestly, his post-game press conferences, best interview that we've ever had here at Alabama, 100%.
Yeah.
The guy is so poised. He's so polished. He's well-spoken. He's articulate. He has an amazing smile. He says all the right things. And not only just coach speak. Like, he says things and that are quote-worthy. And, look, Saban has been he talked a lot of this week about consistency. And he's right. Like, this team has not played a four-quarter game just yet. That's why I'm optimistic. With that said, it's going to be challenging going to Starkville. Stark Vegas, that's what they called it. Sound off in the comment box if you've ever been to Starkville, Mississippi. Hey, trivia for everyone in the comment box. Trivia, okay?
Yes. Okay.
Who is the most famous NFL player to ever come out of Starkville, Mississippi?
Like, who's literally from the town or played at Mississippi State?
No, from Starkville.
Literally from the town.
From the town.
Jeez.
JD's been to Starkville. All right. So they ring these cowbells, okay? And it's these cowbells that ring, and the cowbell is passed on from like parts. If I was leaving Starkville, I would pass on my cowbell to you. And so these cowbells, I would give it to you.
Pass it on.
I would give it to you, and I'd be like, shake this at the game in my honor. And you would take it and shake it at the stadium.
You're saying that, like, if I was a Mississippi State fan and I was going to go to one game, I would go to that game, but on my way out, I'm supposed to hand my cowbell.
This would be your cowbell that you like loved and appreciated and used. But if you like ever, if you weren't going to go to any games or if you're going to die or something, you would give it to me.
See, Kyle, honestly, Kyle, I've been to a couple of SEC venues on the road as an Aggie fan, and I really enjoyed them, but I do not want to go to Starkville just because of those cowbells. Have you been in that stadium? Like,
yes,
how loud
yes,
is it?
It's loud. It's the worst. And there's another place that's worse. it's Neyland, Tennessee. They play that Rocky Top song, and they play it over and over and over and over, and it never stops. Like, every single thing that happens, like, dun, 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 it never stops. The cowbells, they have the giant video board. It's gigantic. It's one of the biggest things in Mississippi that's ever been built. Hey, Tracy, let's get Tracy a sticker. Yeah, it's Jerry Rice. Congratulations, Jerry Rice. But I think Jerry Rice and Colby, you guys,
Jerry was from Owen,
Sherman, you guys get free ice cream cones from TCBY. Tell them Ketch sent you. but they have this big video board, and on the board, on like their scoreboard, it says, like it shows you when to ring the cowbell and when not to ring the cowbell.
Oh my God. Yeah, so when the offense comes out there, it's like, don't ring the cowbell. Yes. Wow. Okay. A whole nother thing.
Just Kyle, just so you know, and Blake sent it through chat, and I was just about to say it. Get ready for Oklahoma and a song that only includes two words. And you want to talk about a song that wrongfully will get stuck in your head.
Huh.
Those people just walk around going, Boomer Sooner, Boomer Sooner, Boomer Sooner, Boomer Sooner, Boomer Sooner. That's what they do. Like, that is what they do. And trust me, it sucks.
Yeah, that seems pretty terrible. Yeah, Rocky Top is up there for sure. Like, if you're not a Tennessee fan, you know, it's Rocky Top. They must play it like 200 times a game.
Yeah. All right, so Ketch, while you were dealing with whatever you were dealing with, I got two or three, I think I threw at Kyle. So you got one more for him?
No, I'm good.
Okay. fair enough.
Well, you asked about my shirt, right?
Oh, yeah, we double checked on the shirt.
Okay.
People called it crimson, but you can compare. Yeah. Again, look at this. It's a perfect – look, I'm maroon. Kyle's rocking the crimson behind him there. Yeah. Ketch is not wearing either of those colors. It's not either one. I'm going with Arizona dust today is the color, I think, of Ketch's shirt.
It's very Hotel California.
Yeah.
California. Yeah. In fact, Kyle, you help us out. If you could give Ketch's shirt color like a Home Depot or Lowe's paint color kind of name, what would you call that?
I would call it soft burgundy.
Ooh, soft burgundy. I like that.
Yeah, you like that?
I like it.
Does that work?
There you go.
It feels like a cologne, is what.
Right?
Especially with your voice. Give me a nice read on the soft burgundy cologne. Try to sell me some soft burgundy cologne.
It's been known to put hearts in Aggie fans. Try out our new collection of cologne titled Soft Burgundy, sponsored by Ron Burgundy, only at Home Depot.
It does feel a little Sex Panther-ish.
It really does. Yeah, exactly. 60% of the time, it works every time. That is good stuff. Kyle Henderson, enjoy. Are you headed to Stark Vegas, by the way?
Yeah, Stark Vegas is going to be a late one. It's like a two-hour drive. There's really no places to stay at. So the game's at 8 p.m. It's going to be a late one, but that's how you roll sometimes. Oh, Rustic Clay. Someone said Rustic Clay inside the comment box.
Rusty Clay. I like that one too. That's a very good one. I like it. We'll take your earplugs if you need them, and we'll talk to you down the road, brother.
All
thank
right,
you.
See you guys.
Take care, Kyle.
Kyle Henderson. Look at that. Sultry voice on demand. Kyle Henderson. Well.